If you create a level for your game, Unity will save it automatically. But what happens if there are changes during runtime? Or even better, the player creates a big part of the tilemap. Well, then you need to save it on your own. But don't worry, creating a basic saving and loading system is quite easy. Of course, the details will take more time, but this is your part, not mine, so let's start. All you need to save tilemaps is of course some way to edit a tilemap during runtime. In my case, I used the code from my tutorial series about in-game tilemap editing. Here we can draw different tiles onto different tilemaps. So the result of this video will also work for all your existing tilemaps in your scene. Yay! I start by adding two buttons, one for saving and one for loading. You can do this now however you want, but at least you need some way to trigger saving and loading. Of course, this can also happen during exit and on start or something like this. Now, to add some click events, we need a new script first. Let's call it SaveHandler. And now add public methods for saving and loading. We will leave them empty for now. Also, import the UnityEngine.tilemaps package at the top. We will need it. I also add three variables. The first one is a private dictionary. You will see its use case soon. Just add the line like I did. The second one is a variable we need to fill in the inspector, so make it serialized. It is of type bounceInt and will be the border of the tilemap area we are saving. More explanation later. And the third one is the file name of the file, which will be saved and loaded. I make it serialized and also give it a default value. Make sure to always add the file type of JSON as well. Now, to save the content of one or more tilemaps, we need those tilemaps. Of course, you can just use a prefilled list where you add the maps, but in our case, the tilemaps are generated during runtime based on the different layers we can draw onto. So I will show you how to get all the tilemaps from your scene. The initTilemaps function will be called onStart. I will use the findObjectsOfType method. This will now return all tilemaps that exist in the scene. Yeah, that was easy. Just make sure to use objects, which returns an array. Explicit type declaration helps with errors like this. Now, instead of just saving the list, I will rather save this data in the dictionary from earlier. By using the name of the tilemaps object, it is easier to find the according map on loading, because the name will be our unique identifier for the different maps during saving. Now, be aware that you can have tilemaps with the same name. This will lead to errors in this script. So if this is true in your case, you need to expand your identifier by something besides the name. Just make sure that it stays the same during play sessions. I loop through the retrieved maps and add the entry to the dictionary. Now, that's nice. Can work. Sometimes. The thing here is, like I said, the tilemaps get created during runtime, in the start method of the according script. And we retrieve them also in a start method. So we need to make sure that this method here is being executed later than the one that creates the maps, right? It's actually quite easy. In Unity, go to Edit, Project Settings. Now find the script execution order. Every script that is not mentioned somewhere here will be executed during this default time slot. So let's just add our save handler and put it at the end. That's fine, as long as it's below the default time. And while we are here, let's prepare the buttons. At first, add the script to your scene. I will add it to my Universal Manager object. Then you can go to your buttons and add a new onClick event. Drag and drop your Manager object into the game object slot. And now you can look for your script and the according method. If you can't see your methods, make sure they are public. Repeat this for your load button as well. Now that this is prepared, let's switch back to the script. During start, all the tilemaps will be saved to the dictionary. So onLoad or save, we can easily work with them. Of course, if you add or remove tilemaps during runtime, you need to call the initTilemaps method before executing the saving or loading methods. For the saving part, I highly recommend you to watch my tutorial about saving and loading with JSON files. We will use the SaveHandler script I explain in this tutorial for this saving process as well. So it will definitely help your understanding of the process and might help you adapting the process to your own needs. But if you don't want to, you will find a script link in the description. But the following explanations assume you know about this video. And not a requirement, but recommended, is my tutorial about saving high score lists. This will show you another use case on how to use the SaveHandler script. At first, we need to define a format which will be saved. We do this by creating a native C# class. Let's start by importing the system package. That we can convert a class to a JSON object, the class needs to have this serializable tag above. Therefore, the import of system. The following variables now also need to be public. Our first one is the key. This must be the key of the dictionary we created earlier. Remember, in my case this is the name, but in all cases it should be a string. This variable will be used to search in a dictionary and to retrieve the according tilemap when loading. This is much faster than looking for a matching value in a list. The second variable is a list of type tileInfo, which will hold all the tiles being used. What is tileInfo, you might ask? This, a new class. Every single tile will be represented by an object of this class. It consists of the tile base and the position in the tilemap as vector3 int. That it's easier for me later to create instances of this class, I also add a constructor here, where I assign the given parameters to the variables. So, for every tilemap that exists in our scene, we instantiate an object of type tilemapData. Then, for every filled tile, we create an object of type tileInfo with the information of the position and the used tilebase. Then, every tileInfo object will be saved in our tilemapData object. That should then be all information you need for one tilemap. Now, let's code the process I just explained. Since we are working with several tilemaps, but don't worry, it also works with one, we want to save all those tilemap data objects to a list. This list will then later be passed to the SaveHandler script from my mentioned tutorial. For each tilemap in our tilemap dictionary, we create a new object of tilemap data. We don't have a constructor here, because it is not necessary, so I can only assign the key like this. Looping through a dictionary will retrieve an object where you can use .value and .key, so we can easily assign the key of the dictionary to this variable like this. Now we want to check the tilemap for existing tiles. For this you need some kind of boundaries. You can either create those borders manually, like I will show next, or you retrieve them automatically from your tilemap, like this coding snippet does. But let's do it by hand, so you have a chance to understand it better. Taking a look at my game, I can't pan, so my boundaries are quite simple. The center of my tilemap is also the center of my screen. So my width is currently like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 tiles wide in one direction, or 18 in total, and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 10 tiles tall. Earlier we created that bounceIn variable, remember? This is where you need to define those borders. Choose the lowest position on the bottom left. In my case this would be -9 for x and -5 for y. To reach to the top right, just set the full size, here 18 and 10. For me, my tilemaps are all located at 0 for the z-axis. Please make sure to set them all to 0 or to change the boundaries values here if your tilemaps are located differently. Now, back in the code, we can loop through all the XY combinations of the given boundaries. This looks like this, with two for loops. If your z-axis is not 0, you need to add this value to the loop as well, or if it is one static value, like 0 in my case, for all your tilemaps, just follow along and replace the 0 in the upcoming variable. Since we want to save the position as vector3 int, let's create a variable for it and use the values from the loops for x and y. I set the z-axis to 0. Change it if needed. Now we can retrieve the tile base based on the position variable. At this point we either retrieve a tile base or a null value. Saving null values might not be a great idea, so let's add this if statement. If we retrieve an actual tile base, we can create an object for it of type tileInfo. Thanks to the constructor, we can just pass the two parameters for the tile base itself and the position to the brackets here. Then we can add this object to the list of tileInfo objects, which exists in our tilemap data class. This list already exists because we not only declared it, but also initialized it here. Now this will happen for all the tilemaps and all the tiles inside the given boundaries. But right at the end of our forEach loop, before the code jumps to the next tilemap, let's add this tilemapData object to the list we created at the start of this onSave method. So I mentioned my file handler script from the JSON tutorial. Grab it from your storage or get it from the GitHub link in the description. Either way, you need to drag and drop it into your scripts folder. Now we can just call the script from any other script by its class name. That works because it is static. We call the saveToJSON method and assign the type of our list tilemapData as type. The method takes two arguments, the data itself and the file name. Now if you made everything correct, the saving will work. Let's start play mode. I then draw on two of my tilemaps. Here in the hierarchy you can see all my 5 tilemaps. That means in the saveJSON we will then see 5 tilemapData objects, but only 2 of them will have entries of type tileInfo. Now let's check it. I will click the save button. This logs the path where the file is saved, which comes from a line in the file handler script. So let's open this file. With some auto-formatting, it also looks more readable. Here we have the 3 empty entries and the 2 filled ones. Tiles, the array of the tileInfo objects, is here. But what happened to the file type we defined as tilebase? This is what a tilebase looks like during runtime, if you debug it. Looks a bit different, doesn't it? Well, what we can see is in the JSON is, obviously, the instance ID. Okay, but what does this mean? The instance ID of an object is a unique identifier. So, based on this ID, you can find unambiguously an object. Those IDs here reference to the tiles that have been created earlier, and it's quite simple to use them. But this approach comes with one downside. You can only use the instance ID if you do not generate the tiles during runtime. Everything generated during runtime will have a different instance ID every time. In this case, you need to use something constant as reference for those tiles, like the position from the sprite sheet they are coming from, or whatever you use. This won't be part of the tutorial. On load, the first thing we need to do is to retrieve the parsed JSON file. Fortunately, the file handler script will handle this part. Because we want to retrieve a list, we also need to call the method which reads a list. The magic in the background. Remember the list we saved, where the tilebase contained some more information? Well, when transforming the JSON back to the list, the instance ID gets automatically converted to the tilebase object again. The saved and the loaded list look the same. Taking a look in the debugger. That's the really big advantage of using the instance ID. Now we can loop through the data. Since we saved the dictionary key in the data, we can now easily retrieve the according tilemap for the data entry we have. But beforehand, we should check if the key exists in the dictionary, or else the code will throw an exception. We will prevent this error by checking it. If it does not exist, I will simply log an error message and skip the rest of this loop iteration, and therefore this entry. Now I can create a variable which tilemap I want to fill. Because we did not save the null values, let's clear the whole tilemap before drawing back onto it. If there are entries, I loop through the tiles list which contains the position and the tile base. This one line will now fill the tilemap with the data saved in the JSON. Well, yeah, basically that's it. For all the tilemaps, we assign the single tile values, and there is nothing more to do here. Let's give it a try in play mode. I hope everything works for you. If not, try again, rewatch the tutorial, or compare your own code with the GitHub repo. Also works wonders, and there are some additional comments. Of course, and as usual, this tutorial and script only provides the basic use case, and I hope it is enough to help you to understand how you can save a tilemap data or also other data in Unity. Thank you for watching, and also thank you to everyone supporting me and the channel. Special thanks to my supporters on Patreon, Patrick and Naxvomo. Thank you all. And as usual, if you enjoyed the content, consider liking and subscribing, and I'll see you next time.